In this video, we introduce the idea of electric potential energy generated by a point charge, how to use electric potential in energy calculations, and then we wrap things up with an example of potential and potential energy. So much like we defined electric field as force per unit charge, and I'll post a link to that video real quick, electric potential is defined as the electric potential energy per unit charge. And the units of electric potential, I can see from the equation, are joules per coulomb, but that gets a special name. That's a V for volts. So at some point in space, around some charge distribution, what the potential tells you is how much potential energy you would get for every coulomb of charge you stuck there to interact with that charge distribution. So hopefully it seems intuitive to you that if you doubled the amount of the test charge, you would get twice as much electric potential energy at that point, at that given potential. And we can turn around the definition of potential to make that point more clear. I can say the potential energy of a test charge is given by the size of that charge multiplied by the electric potential at that point in space. So in the picture down here, I have a positive source charge, and I'm interested in this point, this distance r away from it. And I know that if I put a test charge q at that point, I would have a potential energy of kqq over r. And I'll go ahead and post a link back to the video where that was introduced. So if I follow the definition of potential as potential energy per unit charge, I divide a little q out of this thing, and I get an expression for the electric potential as a function of r generated by this source charge q. Now, we will often consider charges that are moving through potential differences that are not generated by point charges specifically, but other distributions of charge. But it remains true that the potential energy of a test charge is going to be equal to QV. And if I want to look at a change in potential energy, I would take the final potential energy minus the initial. I would get the test charge times the final voltage minus the initial. In other words, the change in the potential energy is given by the size of the charge multiplied by the potential difference between the starting and finishing positions. There's a useful analogy here. Electric potential is very much like height for electrostatics. So if you think back to gravitational potential energy, that was mg times the y coordinate. And mg I could refer to as the weight. So if I compare the electric potential energy, that's the size of the charge times the electric potential, to the gravitational potential energy, then charge is playing the role of weight, and electric potential is playing the role of height. If I put twice the charge into this formula, that's like having twice the weight, which would double your potential energy. If I go to twice the potential or the voltage, that's like doubling the y coordinate, and I get twice the potential energy. Finally, if I look at the formula for the change in gravitational potential energy when the y coordinate changes, that's mg times delta y. And I can see that when a charge goes through a change in potential, that's just like a mass going through a change in heights. And I can compute the change in potential energy and potentially use that in energy conservation calculations. So thinking of electric potential as height, it builds up what I refer to as the electrostatic landscape. And that's what's in this picture on the bottom right. Near a negative charge, I have negative potential. I can see that if I plug in a negative Q into this formula, then in the neighborhood of that charge, I'm going to have negative potential. And the smaller R is, the bigger it is. So it's spiking to negative infinity there. Near a positive charge, I have positive potential. The closer you get, the larger it gets. And so near positive charges, I have hills in the electrostatic landscape. And near negative charges, I have valleys. And if I were to put a positive charge into this landscape, if I think about electric force like Coulomb's law, I can tell this charge is going to run to the left. But we have a new way of thinking of it now. I have a potential energy like there's a hill at the starting position, and this charge is going to roll away from the hill and toward the valley. So my charge is spontaneously moving in the direction of decreasing potential energy. So one thing you have to be careful about in this picture is that I have all these charges situated in a one-dimensional world. They're all along the x-axis here. So the charge is not literally rolling down the hill in a two-dimensional sense, but it moves from the high potential regions to the low potential regions. One final complication of this electrostatic landscape analogy is that electrostatics is twice as complicated as gravitation because we have two different flavors of charge, but only one flavor of mass. So I could ask myself, what happens if I put an electron in this landscape? So there's a little negative charge. And this little negative charge, of course, is going to be repelled from the negative charge here and attracted to the positive charge over here. What does that mean in the electrostatic landscape? It means that negative charges sort of have this property of being negative mass. It would run out of this valley and up the hill instead of running down the hill and down into the valley. All right, so in summary, positive charges will go from high potential to low potential. Negative charges will spontaneously move from low potential to high potential. Let's wrap things up with a quick example. So in this example, I have a 1 microcoulomb charge, and I said it's fixed at the origin. This is going to play a critical role in part C. What I mean is this charge is not allowed to move. It's not allowed to take any kinetic energy. In part A, I'm asked to find the electric potential 10 centimeters from this charge. And so I just plug into my potential formula. The potential as a function of R is KQ over R. K is the Coulomb's law constant, 8.99 times 10 to the 9th Newton meters squared per Coulomb squared. Q is 1 microcoulomb, that's a millionth of a coulomb, so 10 to the negative 6th. And R is 10 centimeters or 0.1 meters. When I run the numbers on this, I get a potential of 89,900 volts, which if you have any experience in your everyday life with voltage, you know that's an enormous voltage, which is more verification that the coulomb is a huge unit of charge. In part B, we're asked for the potential energy of an electron that's sitting at that point. And so the idea here is that I don't have to go back and work from scratch to find the potential energy. Instead, I can plug into the formula, potential energy is given by Q times V. And if I plug in the charge on the electron, 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs, and plug in the voltage at this point, remember a volt is equivalent to a joule per coulomb. So that might be a nice way of tracking the units here. I can see the coulombs cancel and I get joules out of it. I'm going to get a negative potential energy. And this comes out to negative 1.44 times 10 to the negative 14 joules. Recall that when I have unlike charges, the potential energy between them is negative. And the closer they get, the more negative that becomes, which is good because when the potential energy decreases like that, I'll see the kinetic energy increase. So it makes sense. In part C, I'm saying, assuming the electron is released from rest, compute its speed when it arrives at the 8 centimeter separation point. So it's only moved 2 centimeters toward this positive charge. I have a couple options here. I could compute the potential energy directly using the formula, potential energy is K Q1 Q2 over R, or I could compute the potential at this location and then multiply it by the size of the charge for the electron. Since we've already done enough problems this way, and this video is about potential, why don't we do it the potential way? So I'm going to get the potential at this new separation distance. All right, all that changes there is the 0.1 got changed to a 0.08. And I end up with a potential of 112,375 volts. So now, rather than plugging in QV to find the potential energy of the electron at this point, why don't I just go ahead and say what I want is the change in potential energy, which is given by Q times the change in the potential. And that's negative 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs times delta V. Delta always means final minus initial. There's my final, and here's my initial. All right, so my final potential is greater than my initial. In other words, this is that case of an electron running uphill in the electrostatic landscape. When I crunch the numbers, I find a potential energy difference of negative 3.60 times 10 to the negative 15 joules. And there's no need to be formal about the energy conservation calculation. I see that the potential energy has gone down. I have a decrease in potential energy. All of that potential energy, of course, goes into the kinetic energy of the electron. Again, it's key to say that the positive charge was fixed at the origin, so I don't have to worry about it moving as well. So all this potential energy goes into the kinetic system, and I can write down K equals 1/2 mv squared. I solve for V by multiplying by 2, dividing by M, and square rooting, and I get V equals the square root of 2K over M, and my kinetic energy is going to be positive 3.6 times 10 to the negative 15 joules. And this is something you need to look up. The electron mass is 9.11 times 10 to the negative 31 kilograms. When I crunch the numbers, I get 8.89 times 10 to the 7 meters per second. So crunching the numbers real quick, this electron is moving about 30% the speed of light. So this is definitely in a velocity regime where we should be adjusting by using special relativity. But that's something we'll get back to when we actually focus on special relativity in this course. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.